I believe that the first counsel who should be arguing is Mr. I hope I'm pronouncing it, Mr. Keim. We have you here. Did I pronounce
that's correct, Your Honor?
Did I get it right?
Yes, Your Honor, it's Keim.
Oh, great, terrific. So, Mr. Keim, you're going to go first. Mr. White, you'll go second. And Mr. Lawless, you'll go third. All right. And Mr. Keim, if you could just, as part of your presentation today, just clarify what issues in this case are the same as the one we just heard, and I know there's one that's different.
Right. Very, very well. May it please the court, my name is Tom Keim, and I represent the petitioner hospitals in this case. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal.
Very well.
I'll pay attention to the timer. So the key difference in this case versus the first case is the fact that the written authorization for dues deductions in this case did not comply with federal criminal statute section 302 C4 of the Labor Management Relations Act. That's 29 USC section 186 C4. The criminal statute, which the parties agree is subject to de novo review by the court, provides what is necessary for an employer to deduct money from an employee's paycheck and remit it to the union representing dues payments. The statute states, as an exception to the general prohibition, that such a deduction is possible and legal if the employer has received from each employee on whose account such deductions are made a written assignment which shall not be irrevocable for a period of more than 1 year or beyond the termination date of the applicable collective agreement, whichever occurs sooner. The authorization in this case at issue does not provide for the revocation upon expiration of the collective bargaining agreement. The authorization simply says that the authorization shall remain in effect and shall be irrevocable unless revoked in writing to both the employer and the union a registered letter during the period October 1 to October 15 on each year of the agreement and shall be automatically renewed as an irrevocable checkoff from year to year unless revoked as herein above provided, irrespective of whether I am a union member. So not only does it fail to contain the language that it's revocable upon expiration, it specifically provides that it's only revocable annually. And our position and the hospital's position has been since discovering the problems with the authorization has notified the union of its intent to stop dues deductions in order to not violate a federal criminal statute. The purpose of these statutes is to protect employees from the abuse or potential abuse of employers and labor organizations that enter into sweetheart deals or arrangements which take advantage of employees. The Congress could have made this only an unfair labor practice if the statute was violated, but they didn't. They went further and they found that it was more than an unfair labor practice. In fact, it was a violation of criminal law. So the hospitals notified the union and stopped the dues deduction. As part of that notification, the hospitals requested authority, contrary authority, explaining that the authorizations were valid. They also agreed to deduct dues upon receipt of a valid authorization and in fact provided and authorization for this labor organization that it had obtained. And the union, under the expired agreement, had access to the hospital, access to meeting rooms, access to every break room, access to the cafeteria, and access to bulletin boards in order to obtain new authorizations. So our position is to deduct dues would have violated the statute. Our second position is we had no obligation to bargain about whether this document was valid, because it wasn't. And the purpose of bargaining about something that you can't agree to serves no purpose, and there's no obligation to do so.
Counsel, what precisely was missing in the authorization? What language would have resolved this question?
The language that would have resolved it is the language straight from the statute, which provides that an employee's authorization is irrevocable except upon expiration, or the termination date is what the language of the statute says, that the termination date of the applicable collective agreement. So employees in this authorization were not notified that they could revoke upon expiration of the collective bargaining agreement. And in this case, the revocation periods in the authorization of October 1 to October 15, the annual revocation period, did not coincide with the expiration of the collective bargaining agreements, which was in late spring. So the employees had no notice whatsoever of a right to revoke their authorization as required by the statute.
Does the statute require that the authorization form include such notice?
Our position is it clearly does, because it's specific and it's for the protection of the employee. The employee has a very limited opportunity to get out of this authorization. It has to do so at least annually and upon expiration of the agreement. Deduction is valid whether the employee is a member of the union or not. So the employee should be on notice of all of the employee's rights. That's the key here. This applies to employee rights, and it's a protection to prevent abuse.
Excuse me, one other question. C5, 302C5 expressly requires such a writing in other situations, but there's no such requirement in 4. What should we make of that?
Well, the documents that pertain to the authorization forms are one or two paragraphs. So it's not like there's not requirements listed. And the employer does have to receive a written assignment. The employer has to receive a written assignment. So it has to be in writing. The 5 applies to more complex and more detailed documents like pension plans and welfare benefit plans, things that have many more aspects to them to comply with law. So our position is the reason that subparagraph is so much longer is that the documents are so much longer, but our position also is if you look at the total length of a document, there's as many or more requirements per paragraph for the authorization than there is for these benefit plans.
Yeah, counsel, one question for you is this, and I'm gonna ask government counsel the same question. There is a case from 1959 called Felter versus Southern Pacific Company. It's 359 U.S. 326. And it has a similar issue to this case. Now, it's a different labor statute, but it's in the ballpark. And there, that case seemed to suggest that even though the checkoff assignment revocation didn't have all the right language in it, it was still valid. And I didn't see this case cited by either party. And so I'm not expecting you to know it off the top of your head, but you may want to take a look at that case. And we do have a procedure we'll call the 28J letter where you can submit supplemental authority. Again, it's Felter versus Southern Pacific, 359 U.S. 326. And then that case, anyway, so just that case is in my mind. I'm not expecting you to know it off the top of your head. But you, after argument, you may want to submit something on that case.
Okay, Your Honor, I would say, you know, that's a Railway Labor Act case, and I don't know if there's a corresponding criminal statute that applies to the Railway Labor Act as opposed to the forum we're in, which is the National Labor Relations Act and the NLRB instead of the Railway Labor Act. But I appreciate the court bringing that to our attention, and we will definitely look at that.
Yeah, fair enough. Did you want to reserve your time?
Yes, Your Honor.
Very well. You may proceed, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'll pause just at the outset of the argument here to note that there is substantial overlap between these two cases because I'll refer to the second case as the board's decision as Desert Springs 2. This involved application of the rule we were just discussing in Valley Hospital 2, and the employers in this case raised largely identical or the same arguments both before the board and this court. And so I will pause just to ask if the court has any questions about the merits of the board's Valley Hospital 2 rule. I take it that the employers have not presented any objection to the actual substance of the board's decision before the court today, but I did want to give the court an opportunity if it has any questions about the substance of the board's rule. And if not, I can turn to the second issue, which is unique to Desert Springs 2, which, as my opposing counsel was just discussing, is this question of whether the employers were privileged to unilaterally stop deducting or stop dues checkoff based on their interpretation of Section 302C4 and their statement to the union that they thought the actual authorization forms were unlawful. The board provided two independent reasons why that argument fails in this case and why this was an unfair labor practice. First, the board interpreting the plain language of Section 302C4 concluded quite reasonably that nothing in that statute contains or indicates that there's an affirmative notice requirement such that an individual employee's authorization is only valid and only permits an employer to transmit union dues if the actual authorization contains language affirming the employee's rights under Section 2C4. The employers have not cited any case, either an agency case or a criminal case against an employer. I'm certainly unaware of none in the history of the statute where that was the that was held, that these that this was a criminal violation of Section 302C4 because there was some defect in the wording of the authorization forms. As the board explained, that's also consistent with the plain language of Section 302C4. This court, I think, has held that all 302C4 stands for is that in order to have a valid dues checkoff payment from an employer to a union, you need to have authorizations from that individual employee. That's what the statute requires in terms of formalities. Then the statute goes on to affirm that employees have a right under Section 302C4 to revoke their authorization during two specific windows. First, on the anniversary, 1 year anniversary, and secondly, when a contract expires. So the board noted here that regardless of whether employees are told about those rights in the authorization form that they sign, they still have those rights, and they can still revoke, and the employer needs to honor that revocation under 302C4. To Your Honor's question about the Felter case, I did actually look at that case in preparing for the arguments today. I don't want to claim to be too well-versed in the case, but I would note that in the Supreme Court's opinion in Felter, it did note that the legislative history of the Railway Labor Act and the LMRA on this point suggests that Congress had similar intentions in mind. And I agree with Your Honor's reading of Felter that the Supreme Court there noted, I think specifically, that employees cannot waive their revocation rights regardless of the content of an authorization, and that they retain those revocation rights regardless of specific wording. So I think at the end of the day, the board's position is very simple as to this first aspect of its decision, which is that 302C4 simply does not require affirmative notice to employees affirming their statutory rights. And there's no authority to the contrary that I'm aware of. I'd also note that just based on the specific facts of this case, the board offered a reasonable reading of these authorization forms, which is that simply because they refer to the revocation rights and prescribe a window for the yearly revocation, and they simply say nothing about the end of contract revocation. And under established precedent, when one of these authorization forms is silent, it's presumed to be at-will revocation. And so the board offered that as a reasonable reading here. Certainly, that undercuts the employer's argument given the context where this issue is arising, which is a question of whether the employers were entitled to disregard their statutory obligation to bargain with the union before unilaterally ceasing these dues checkoff arrangements. If there's any ambiguity, that certainly undermines that, but the board also found conclusively that 302 simply does not require this, that these forms did not violate 302C4. And I'd also note that 302C4 is a criminal statute. And so under normal principles of interpretation, I think it's reasonable to not interpret that provision as though Congress was making it a criminal violation for an employer to transmit dues when there is a defect, simply a defect in the writing of the revocation form. Here, there's no evidence that any employee attempted to revoke their dues checkoff arrangement or that that was not honored if they had attempted to do so. And turning to the second independent basis for the board's decision, under existing board precedent, which was reaffirmed here, even if an employer is correct or has a credible argument that these forms violated 302, that does not per se relieve it of its obligations to bargain under the Act or allow it to unilaterally cease dues checkoff or, as happened here, present the union with an ultimatum that if the union did not come up with new forms within 5 days or provide case authority to the employer's satisfaction, that they were going to simply terminate this longstanding arrangement. The duty to bargain is a duty to meet and confer in good faith and to discuss the issue with the union as the employee's representative and to come to potential solutions that would ameliorate some of the employer's proffered concerns. And the board outlined some of those potential solutions in its decision. None of that bargaining occurred here, so we don't know how the parties might have resolved this short of simply unilateral termination of the dues checkoff arrangements. I'd also note that the employers in their briefs make a great deal claiming that they were acting in good faith and that they were doing the best they could. That's, I would say, wrong for the reasons I just noted, that they didn't explore any of these alternative avenues which might have assuaged their concerns, alleged concerns that they would be in violation of 302C4 if they made another payment to the union. But number two, the board also made a specific finding of fact in this case that given all of the surrounding circumstances, this appeared to be a pretextual concern proffered by the employers in the midst of contentious successor contract bargaining, and that the employers did not have a legitimate concern about the lawfulness of these forms. I'd also note that in Desert Springs 1, which is not back before the court, but in that case, the board found a host of other unfair labor practices around the same time, which the employers have not contested and are not at issue. But I think that underscores the board's factual finding that here this was simply pretext because the employers were trying to gain leverage in bargaining with the union by cutting off access to these dues checkoff arrangements, which the employers had been complying with for many years. without evident qualms about the wording of the authorization forms, which the employers presumably reviewed when this relationship was first established. And if there aren't any further questions, I'm happy to rest there and simply ask for full enforcement.
Okay, no further questions. Thank you very much, Mr. Weiss, for doing double duty.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Your Honors. My name is Jonah Lawless, and I represent the Service Employees International Union, Local 1107. And I want to focus on 3 points for my limited time here, starting with the elephant in the room, which the hospitals devoted 6 lines of their opening brief to, and that is this court's decision in 2011, authored by Judge Paez, Local Joint Executive Board versus NLRB. I refer to it in my brief as LJEB 3. And in that case, this court said that that the Bethlehem Steel rule that permits employers to end dues checkoff upon expiration of a collective bargaining agreement, that doesn't apply to states where there is where there is no union security clause. In other words, the remedy that the hospitals seek here, which is applying Bethlehem Steel to the state of Nevada, is precluded by Ninth Circuit authority. So what they are asking for is simply unreasonable. It contravenes this court's precedent. The second point that I want to highlight was actually it was brought to my attention by questioning from Judge O'Scanlan, in which you asked in the first case that your memorandum disposition said that the board could change its position, and that is true. That is what your decision said, and you're also correct that what the hospitals in effect are doing is they're asking you all to reinterpret your own decision, and that doesn't make any sense. But just to reassure you, in my brief on pages 19 with the blue bait stamp at the top, I did give a few examples of instances where the Court of Appeals has found flaws in the board's decision and remanded it without vacatur. The hospitals make a big deal that there was no vacatur in this case, and I'm not going to belabor the point about this court's not wanting to disrupt the flow of the administrative agency. But in one of the cases that I cited, just as an example, it's Randall Warehouse of Arizona versus NLRB 252 F3rd 445. It's a D.C. Circuit case from 2001. But there, the Court of Appeal was reviewing a board decision where they found that the union was taking photographs and allegedly surveilling employees during a campaign. And what the board said in Randall 1 was that was not a violation of the act. But what the D.C. Circuit said is that they looked at other board precedent that found that when it's an employer that's taking those photographs, that that was a problem and that the board failed to reconcile those two decisions. And so what they did is the D.C. Circuit remanded the decision, again, without vacatur, and the board changed its mind. And that's a common occurrence, and that's exactly what happened here in this particular case. The third point that I want to touch on is this issue of Section 302. In particular, what the hospitals are asking is they're asking this court to decide a case of first impression. And under this court's precedent under Fundbus Systems 801 F 2nd 1120, that's a Ninth Circuit case from 1986, on cases of first impression, when the court is being asked to interpret a statute, you need to start with the plain language and then look at legislative history and then look at the interpretation of an administrative agency. And what the hospitals provided with you is no judicial authority, no board decision, no treatise, no law review article. All they cite to is, Judge O'Scanlan pointed out earlier, is a decision from the dissent. And that simply is not enough to interpret this statute, especially when, as my as the board pointed out, the plain language is clear. There is no notice requirement. Finally, what this comes down to really is the unions, in order to have resources, they need to collect dues a little bit from everybody so that they can have what it takes to bargain collectively, and that's what the employer sought to undercut here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, counsel. We have some rebuttal time. And you may proceed when you're ready.
Thank you, Your Honor. I think my co-counsel in the first case adequately dealt with the LJEB issue, but I would mention that that case, decision in that case was limited to the law of the case. Decision was vacated. It did not prevent this panel from issuing its decision in Valley Hospital 1, and therefore, you know, our view is that that case is in opposite to the case before the court today. I'd also point out my recollection is the Randall Warehouse case is a D.C. Circuit case, which applies a different standard versus a jurisdictional standard, applies a law of the case standard. So, again, that really goes back to the issues in the first case. I'm happy to answer any additional questions with regard to the Section 304 issue or the other issues issue unique to the second case.
Further, Judge O'Scanlon?
No. Mm-hmm.
No further questions unless you have anything else you want to present. It's up to you, counsel.
No, that's fine, Your Honor. I think it's been well briefed and argued by the parties, and I'm fine to not just ramble on. Thank you.
I thank you for that, and I agree. I want to thank all the counsel in this case for outstanding briefing, outstanding argument. Very, very solid by everybody, which is always good, especially when we have a visitor from the Seventh Circuit. And so with that, this matter is submitted, and this particular panel is adjourned. Thank you.
All rise. This court for this session stands adjourned.